Ipswich Town 1, Burton 0. We are here to discuss it live. We're excited, but we're keeping the ambitions tempered, but we want to hear from you. Get involved in the chat. Go on, Mikey Penty Smith. Hello and welcome to the Blue Monday podcast live, discussing Ipswich Town up or down since 2015. I'm Richard Woodward and this is our post-match live reaction show following Burton 0, Ipswich Town 1. Joining me, he's excited. We're all excited, aren't we? Mikey Penny-Smith, David Diamond. Guys, how about that? What a symbolic victory that was, more than anything, Mikey.
Yeah, we could easily have lost that game, couldn't we? And yeah. On another night, maybe we would have done. We rode our luck, but it was an enjoyable watch, and I thought we were pretty good in the second half.
Would you agree with that, Dave? An enjoyable watch? It was a bit nervy, wasn't it?
At times in the first half, it was a bit kamikaze, wasn't it? I've got to say, it was like almost watching sort of, you know, like a horror film with your sort of hands in front of your face. But yeah, I mean, I know it's an old cliche. They're the sort of games that get you promoted, mate. They really are. You know, showed a lot of character. Saw it out. Yeah, Mikey's right. We did, I guess, ride our luck a little bit in the first half, but and also once in the second half. But yeah, great character and good performances right throughout the team again, I would say.
Yep. Well, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about the game. But as we said, we're going live. We want to hear from you guys. I'm sure you're excited just as much as we are. Charlie D's gone, yes. Kirk's gone, get in there. Let's talk about this guy straight off the bat. Dave, you mentioned performances. Harness now scoring pretty routinely. Who needs a goal scoring number nine?
As I said in the TG group after he scored, he's got an eye for goal, isn't he? He's got that knack. And yeah, I thought he had a really good game. He just joins in really well and hit it early. That was the key with the goal, wasn't it? Just hit it early. Keeper was unsighted, probably a bit flat footed. And yeah, lovely strike again to go with his sort of bundled effort Saturday. And he's great strike at Forest Green. So yeah, he's. Three goals already. Good. Yeah, what a signing.
Yep, against his old club as well. And yeah, it was the kind of first time that we'd really tried from range. You kind of think in those conditions, the slick surface and all that kind of stuff, you should be trying that. So it was good when it paid off. But Mikey, my man of the match, and Kirk's maybe as well. Walton equals epic. How about Christian Walton's performance tonight?
Yeah, well, even if you just ignored his saves tonight, and there was two or three really good important saves, especially the one with his foot in the second half that I'm sure we'll talk about after the Wolfenden mistake. But his distribution was just world class tonight, wasn't it?
And
it's just incredible how much that's come on. I don't know whether that's been coached into him or it's just the confidence, but he looks like he can pass just as well as any of our outfield players at the moment.
Yeah, Walton, here's Chris Nunn, Walton moving above Bart. I mean, I've got a lot of affection, as we already know on the podcast, for Christian Walton. But yeah, what say you guys on Bart versus Walton? Different keepers, different needs.
Different keepers.
Yeah. You don't really need to compare them.
Certainly was different needs when Bart was in goal, wasn't it?
Yeah, true.
Yeah, two very good keepers. And he certainly, I think, you know, fingers crossed, come the end of this season, we will be talking about him in the same breath as we used to talk about Bart. If we're not already.
Yeah, Michael, that was a different type of game from Saturday. 3 points, three wins in a row, as you said. But Mikey, that kind of... We're worried about the level of performance against Bolton, who were playing football against us. Forest Green tried to play football against us. MK Dons tried and definitely failed playing football against us. A very different test and probably one where maybe we take more out of this win than maybe the three that we've had so far, perhaps. Or the other two, sorry.
Yeah, maybe. I think... What was pleasing for me was the way that we got a grip of the game eventually and we did improve, where there was other games in the past where we'd be like, blimey, everything's going against us here. The long throw in the first minute looked like that was going to be, well, I think everyone was worried, weren't they? They were thinking, blimey, they're going to be doing this over and over again. And I think we tried our best to limit the throw-ins, which wasn't easy in the conditions. But I think that we eventually just sort of wisened up to it. The positioning was a little bit better and it was a little less crazy in our own penalty area.
I think with the throws, if you think back to the game, probably a similar game at a similar stage last year, Cheltenham away,
yes,
where we just got undone.
Really,
I know we went one up,
Dave,
but we just got completely undone by the throws. Yeah, we showed a lot more a lot more steel. And yeah, I think eventually we, yeah, first minute apart, we sorted it out quite well, didn't we?
Yeah. Another mention here from Andrew. Jackson works so hard tonight. I thought Jackson's best moments for us was when he turned into Wes Burns down the right hand side, guys. But yeah, he made a contribution up front, didn't he? You know, it's going to be difficult to dislodge Ladapo and Chaplin and harness as that kind of front three. But Jackson made an impression tonight, didn't he?
Yeah, I'm not sure I want to see Jackson playing in that right wing back position, but it didn't really end up. It seemed quite early on there was a bit of a shape change and he moved further up, but he never let go of those defensive responsibilities. He did fight back quite well a couple of times and made a couple of key interceptions around our box, but I think he should have scored when he went up front.
Yeah, bad touch. His energy levels are unbelievable.
They are.
Energy
what about the energy levels about the whole team, Dave, though? You know,
I mean, on the telegram,
the Burton tired off, you know, that high press, that intensity wasn't going to last.
I think quite rightly, Ian Westlake, who I thought was magnificent.
Excellent, wasn't he?
Well, my goodness, but how good
he loves passing football, doesn't he?
What the hell? What does he know about football? Everything. He's brilliant. I think he had it probably right about the Dapbo that he could see he was really, really struggling. You know, he'd put so much effort in. And again, just needs a goal. I think if he's getting in those positions, a goal, and any sort of goal, and I think he's off and running and could well go on a streak. But yeah, Jackson was, absolutely superb at both ends, really.
In terms of tempering, you know, we did this on the Flagship. We just need to calm down a little bit. Mark makes a very good point. We talk about Walton saving our bacon. That's Mark's words here. We were still doing a few casual passing out the back, weren't we? A few iffy bits and pieces. Is that something to be alarmed about? Or is it just...
Yeah, and I think as great as it is and as key as it is, like you brought up at the start of the show, to win a game that was a little bit scruffy and we rode our luck at times. Let's not forget that we did do that quite a lot at the start of the season under Paul Lambert, when we weren't conceding goals, but we were conceding lots of opportunities. You can't keep doing that, but it is you can't be too annoyed when you win a game. I'll be interested to hear what Benjamin Bloom makes of it, because it was a little bit... I mean, the football was very different, wasn't it? And we did create quite a few decent chances of our own in the end, but we, like I said, we did ride our luck, and against better opposition, we're gonna concede goals if we're as sloppy as that in possession.
It's an odd one, isn't it? Because it's not bad defending as such; it's just carelessness on the ball.
Yeah, it's bad defensive defending,
which
isn't
it? Kind of different, you know. No one's like losing their marker or anything like that, which I guess would be more of a concern as such. I mean, there were a couple of times in the first half, Edmonds and Wolfen did in the second half. But they continued, as Westlake had it spot on, you know, they continued to play like that. They didn't just abandon it. They continued to play.
That's McKenna's style, isn't it? Yeah. I mean, to your point there, Mikey, we need to talk about Burton. And obviously, we'll put the lineups in a second, just have a little bit of a summary of the match. I know there's a lot of chat, so we'll get to that as quickly as we can, folks. Keep them coming. You mentioned against better teams. I mean, we've played against, in terms of footballing terms, Bolton probably one of the better teams in the division in that style. When you say better teams, in terms of the style that Burton maybe went at, do you think there are better teams in the division who are going to do that to us, maybe? Is that something we need to be wary of?
Yeah, potentially, because we're just going to concede a bit more possession away from home, aren't we? So we are naturally going to concede a few more chances, balls into our box and things like that against teams like Portsmouth and Peterborough and teams like that. That's more, that's more what I mean.
Okay. But I mean, there will be teams that will put the chances away that Burton missed. And there were some pretty... Walton made good saves, but they were chances that teams should be scoring. Let's have a quick sort of summary of the match, shall we? Let's have a look at the lineups there. Worth noting that Burton, off the back of their 4-4 draw, which could have been a 5-4 defeat, 3-0 up they were against Accrington on Saturday. Two changes for them. Terry Taylor coming in and Oshalaja coming back into the lineup as well. And as for Ipswich, a bit of rotation, some of it we think might be enforced. Jackson, I guess, coming in for Wes Burns, Aluko in for Chaplin, and Lee in for Davis. thoughts on those kind of changes for us? Like, we don't really know the situation with Burns. If McKenna gives an interview and we hear about that, there's a knock, and you mentioned the pre-match stuff, Dave, didn't you?
Was talk on the telly. I wasn't there early enough to see it, and you were obviously munching your way through prawn sandwiches on Saturday, so you didn't see it either. But apparently it looked like he took a knock prior to the get in the warm-up on Saturday, but obviously he came out and probably played his best performance of the season. Lee for Davis, we said on the pod that we weren't sure they would make that change, but yeah, clearly he did, and Lee was, I thought he was immense again. Yeah, very good. Other than that, Aluko for Chaplin, that was a bit of a surprise for me.
Yeah,
I think maybe Chaplin was giving brilliant on Saturday as well, and obviously Young, Yeah, not that Aluko did a lot wrong. Again, he was pretty effective. Perhaps his final ball didn't quite come off tonight. But yeah, it's such a depth of squad that made the changes one in four. So I guess you'd go with it.
Let's talk about these chances very quickly. I mean, Burton's chances created from set pieces largely. First minute, Mikey, this long throw in, and Adami hooks it onto the bar, and then O'Shaughnessy goes in there and gets injured in the process. Yeah, it was a bit of a nervy start, wasn't it?
It was pretty nervy, wasn't it? We just never looked set, did we? And then it was the bouncing ball in our box. And like Westlake kept saying, it's not the first ball that's necessarily the problem. It's reacting to it. And it's that second ball. We didn't win it. It was a good effort, to be fair, the first one. But I think we were ball watching a little bit. I think Walter might have got a touch on it.
I thought so too. Yeah, he definitely got up to it.
Craig off of our parish was at the game, so he probably had a better view of it, and he seemed to think that Walton got a touch to it. But then, I'm not really sure how he didn't turn it in, and he's managed to injure himself quite badly against the post by the looks of it.
Yeah,
but we it was so early on, wasn't it? But yeah,
bit of panic stations there, and he's had to go off injured. Adami has a chance on 22, shot after Harness, loose pass really there.
I thought he was okay, Adami. He looked okay, big man. So I thought he held it up quite well. Quite a nice touch.
Yeah, I mean,
pressed really
in
well.
Terms of lots of balls into the box, really, weren't they? I mean, that was, the set pieces were dangerous, but, there's clearances being made. Generally, we saw those out, although they were pretty relentless, weren't they? And, I'm trying to find the first chance for us, really. I mean, it's maybe the Jackson chance from the edge of the area that loops out for a corner. But for me, the first half culminates in that effort from Powell, Dave. What a strike from Joe Powell, who came on for Shaughnessy.
That was hell of a strike,
shot,
wasn't it? Yeah, yeah, you'd think Walton wasn't sort of really diving at full stretch as such, was he? You think he realised it was going wide, but it was a hell of an effort. Yeah, been interested to see that one from another angle behind the goal.
Yep.
Ladapo had a decent chance, didn't he, Rich?
Oh, was that second half, though?
No, first half. That was the one where...
Down the left.
The touch by Aluko set him free, didn't he? Just dragged it. Should have.
Yeah, I didn't think he did an awful lot wrong there, Dave, because there wasn't anyone following in.
No,
so
there
was. He had to just go across the goalkeeper and just
slightly.
It's one of those where sometimes it will go in off the post, sometimes it will drag a little bit wide.
Yeah. 12 minutes in, yeah. Sorry.
Good run, though. Good run. And
great run.
We played it out from the back for that one as well. It was a really nice move.
Start of the second half, Ian Westlake was saying that we came out and were playing the better team and the better football, and we were improving. I hadn't seen a huge amount about that, and Burton certainly had another flurry early doors. But Mikey, there's this effort on 53 where Danasian's quite smart. We're building up an effort down the right hand side, and rather than Danasian sweeping across into a congested penalty area, he slides it across for Evans, and this is a decent effort, isn't it? Good save, I guess.
Yeah, and that was the first example of us really having a shot from distance. So maybe a sign that McKenna had said, look, we need to pull the ball back around their area because they've got big centre-backs, so we're not going to win the headers. Pull it back and get shots in. And although there was only a couple that reached the goal, there was one or two that sort of were deflected and blocked and whatever. But yeah, it was definitely a clear tactic. And really nice effort that from Evans, and a good save.
And then, Dave, there's this 1 minute of madness where Ladapo does brilliantly to intercept the loose pass, but his first touch and then the finish let him down. Then Burton go up nearly the other end, and and nearly score. Walton has to save with his feet straight
it's
away.
It's the Wolfenden sort of passes it back blind, doesn't get anything anywhere. Yeah, it's two similar chances, really. First of all, their defender passes it blind, or midfield player passes it blind. And it's his first touch. His first touch is it's one of those, and it's so heavy. And he just gets too close to the keeper.
He could have taken it around the keeper, though.
He probably could, actually. I think his first touch almost made his mind up, because it was ended up being closer to the keeper than it did him, although he caught up with it. And then the next one, Wolfenden, that really was hands in front of your face sort of time, wasn't it? And again, I mean, Walton just had one of those games. He wasn't going to get beaten by anything, was he?
No.
Just incredible point blank. Just...
Should score, though, shouldn't they? There,
oh, he's got to bury that.
Yeah.
He's got to bury that.
And then punishment a few minutes later. Mikey, we've mentioned it very briefly, but Harness, we know, can do this, you know?
Yeah, it was just a... just a touch of class from him, wasn't it? Just getting the ball out of his feet nice and wide so he can wrap his foot around it. And it was just the perfect shot for the conditions, wasn't it? Because it was a low drive, but one that was bouncing before it reached the goal. So it just accelerated a little bit. Goalkeeper was just left stranded, wasn't it? He didn't even attempt to dive, because I think the way that Harness has moved across his man just absolutely did him. And what I would say about Harness is I've heard from Portsmouth fans that he has games where he just doesn't do much, but he looks brilliant on his day. I think that might be more of a reflection on Portsmouth style. I think if you get him the ball a lot, at times he does do some odd things in attack, doesn't he? He can be a little bit wasteful at times, and sometimes his touch isn't quite there. But if you keep giving it to him, the quality is clearly there. He plays some lovely passes. And he's clearly got a decent shot on him with both feet, as we've seen.
Yeah, and they've been playing him wide right as well. And he's playing left side, kind of number 10 for us. So maybe, in McKenna, we trust. I mean, in terms of clear-cut chance, we mentioned the Jackson effort, which kind of hits the back, kind of stanchiony thing. But it's probably the most clear-cut chance for Burton is Brayford's header from the free kick, which Walton kind of plucks out of the air. That's probably the again, best chance for them. But yeah,
I must admit, the corner last minute, Shades of Oxford last year, I took my headphones on and stepped back from the screen. Not that it had any effect, but made me feel better.
But fortunately, Dave, Mikey, we see it out. There's 3 points there. And as everyone's telling us in the chat, top of the league. A little bit of a margin to third as well, which is very helpful indeed. If you're watching us, we will go on as long as the chat is bustling, so we'll get to that in a minute. If you watch on YouTube, do give us a thumbs up, get us up the algorithms, that will help us out. And Daniel Whittison, thank you very much. Thank you for joining us. Chris, I mean, this kind of sums it up. This is certainly from the school of Ian Westlake, Mikey, such composed football even under pressure. Do you think a bit of horses for courses sometimes, or are you kind of big
I'm a bit like Ian Westlake, really. I do like seeing us just playing it out, especially as we've got the ball players. But it does get to a point where if you keep giving the ball away, and it was chucking it down with rain as well, I think eventually you've got to just say, look, let's take a few less risks. And to be fair, we did that at the end of the first half. I don't know what minute it would have been, maybe 35 minutes.
And started waving everyone up, didn't he?
Exactly, yeah. And from there, we looked a little bit less shaky. But then we came out on the second half and we were doing it again, and obviously Wolfenden just nearly made it look silly. But I just think when we're struggling to hold it up front, because Ladapo wasn't really getting much change out of those defenders, you're going to create so many more chances by playing it out nicely from the back and moving the ball properly around the pitch. And I'm a big fan of it, but at times you do need to someone does need to sort of take the lead, which Walton did to him. He showed his maturity there and his leadership, didn't he?
You won't get any better evidence than that than MK on last Saturday, will you?
Well,
really. Yeah. But no, Mikey's right. It was good to see
philosophy, which we've been banging on about for years, haven't we? So we should be complaining now when we keep doing it.
Well, I think now we've got the player. Prior to this, we didn't have the players to do it. Now we've got the squad, players and squad to do it.
Speaking of Lee Evans, is Tom Lee Evans quietly going about his business, has been consistently good so far. Agree with that, Dave?
Yeah, I would say not quite so effective tonight because it wasn't that sort of game. But again, superb. Yeah, as when he was on the ball, seldom wasted a ball, did he? Always available. Like I said, not quite as effective as I think there wasn't that sort of game as it. Yeah, the ball was disappearing over his head, but yeah, when he did land on the ball, he was superb and he, yeah, worked hard again.
Yeah, he looks like a nailed on 7 out of 10 at the moment, doesn't he?
Yeah, yeah. No, you wouldn't. Yeah. It'll be interesting to see when Don Ball's fit, but yeah, you can't. I wouldn't say dislodge him at any moment soon if he continues to play to that standard.
This one from George. I think I certainly endorse this sentiment. Strangely, I think I'm more buzzing after this win than Saturday. Teams who go up weather the storm and win games like this. I don't know if he means to get a weather pun in there given the conditions, Mikey. But I mean, maybe it was the Aspel cider that was coursing through my veins on Saturday afternoon. But I definitely was a bit more happy about that one. But closer game, obviously. But George has got a point, though, isn't he?
Yeah, and I think a lot of people are making that point in the comments that this is what champions do. But champions also beat good teams like Milton Keynes 3-0 at home, don't they? So it's one of those. But yeah, I guess it's what you're into, isn't it?
Yeah,
like just grinding out results sometimes it can be just as enjoyable. But I think I prefer the ones where you grind them out against teams that are maybe a little bit dirty. And it's sort of given you a really, like a bit of a nasty game. But I don't think Burton really did that.
No.
They did. Terry Taylor made a couple of pretty bad tackles early on.
And he
didn't get booked. But then after that, they didn't look particularly physical. And one thing I also noticed was they never really seemed to complain about some decisions that went against them. And they weren't getting in the ref's ear at all. I think the ref actually had a pretty good game by not booking the players. I know I agreed with you, Rich, early on, in the Telegram when you said he needs to book someone, otherwise this is going to get silly. But somehow he managed to get control over the game without doing it, which was nice.
Jedi mind tricks there, yeah.
I think Jimmy Floyd was doing more than his fair share with the fourth official, to be honest.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, and his number
loves
two
a
as
bit
well.
Of that, doesn't he?
Hopefully someone in the chat has answered Chris Nunn's question here. When was the last 3-win streak? It's certainly been a while, hasn't it? So maybe we come back to that one if someone can enlighten us in the chat. Blue Walton, twice the player since the BM interview. Not for me to say, Blue. Not for me to say.
Is there any coincidence with that, Rich? Is that what he's getting at, alluding to there? So no coincidence.
You know, once the camera stopped rolling, we had a chat. And
she's telling me, like, left foot, you have to drive through the ball. Got to drive through it, Christian. It's no good just side foot.
Got to follow through.
Drive through it.
So not for me to say, Blue, but very kind of you. And as always, afterwards, I'll put a link in the top right-hand corner for that interview, which I'm very proud of. Had a good old chat with Christian Morton.
Probably so.
Roman Lario, there you go. Lee was superb, says Skip, one of the Telegram alumni. I thought Jackson did really well in an unfamiliar position. Dave, you mentioned Lee when we talked about the lineups. Do you want to talk to him about him a little bit more?
Good
in the air,
good,
isn't
he? Defended well, good in the air, strong. Very good on the deceptively good on the ball. Very good on the ball. Seldom wastes a ball. Yeah, another really good game. And yeah, good to see him get a start because he's, you know, I think he's fleeting sort of substitute appearances. He's deserved a start.
Mm. He's good in the air as well, isn't he, Dave?
He is good in the air.
So wins a lot of headers.
So is Davis as well. So we're sort of quite well served there. B, I would expect Shrewsbury Saturday, maybe slightly different game. I'd expect Davis to be back perhaps Saturday, but a nice problem for the manager to have there.
Certainly, indeed. Julia makes a good point here. A result earned without Burns, which I guess is positive. Go on, Mikey.
For the first time under Kieran McKenna, according to Renegade Statman.
There you go. And we famously and very harshly said that Wes Burns cost Paul Cook his job when he got injured as well. So, yeah, there you go. It just states the importance of Burns. And, you know, I was watching the game with a mate and we were sort of saying that when Burns is out of the team, the formation, the system sometimes doesn't really drill. And Danassi, who had an amazing game on Saturday, had a few shaky moments first half. So it took us a while to reacclimatise without Burns. But second half, we definitely figured it out, didn't we?
Maybe second half, there was one passage of play where he pace of Danassian, where he out the wide player. He absolutely gave the wide player. Mm. Probably did have a sort of yard or two start on him. He absolutely destroyed him, didn't he?
Mm. Yeah.
Didn't see that pace against Blackburn at home a few years ago, did we, Dave?
It didn't really, no. No.
Don't take us back there. Adam Flatt enjoying Harness's dreamy blue eyes for goal. Yeah, indeed. Yeah. Michael's question here, Dave. Jackson's best position for you? He's not in a 9 nor a wing back, nor a 10.
Well, I'd probably agree, but certainly in that wide right role, I would certainly suggest any or even wide left, but I'd say probably wide right. I quite like him. I quite liked him when he went there tonight. But he can almost play both roles, can't he? But we saw him at MK last season, predominantly play that left role, didn't we? So he can. But yeah, I like to see him in a wide area. I think that's where he does his best work and can drag the, you know, can sort of drag the team up when we're struggling. Can drag the team up with him, really.
Yep.
And for a striker, there's no ego there, Rich. He'll just play anywhere and just give it a good go. I'm not a huge Caden Jackson fan, really, but you can't fault his commitment this last year and the way that he'll just play in different positions and just give it his all. His best position, unfortunately for him, is playing up front in a 4-4-2, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
So he's not.
I thought you were going to say on the bench, Mikey, but but off the bench, I mean that pace as well. You know, and we've seen it. He's been, you know, brought on.
Just an amazing turnaround, isn't it? I mean, if anyone had said after the new year, look, when was that MK game? Early February, was it? You know, Jackson's going to be here next year and would it get extended, you know, another 2 years, I think he got. You think, well, you're crazy, because no way, but, you know, fair play to him. And who knows what he would achieve last year if he hadn't, you know, got the injury.
Yeah, indeed. Rob's point here, Mikey, after enduring a few managers who never seem to be able to make in-game adjustments, it's great to see McKenna spotting the problem, making the required changes. Do you want to elaborate a little bit on that point from your perspective? I guess maybe there was a bit of on-pitch problem solving by the team first half. We mentioned Walton changing up the distribution, but did McKenna change something at halftime that maybe Rob's picked up on? Did you spot anything? Or just a point in general that you want to observe? I mean, McKenna, so, you know, we need to just remember.
Yeah, the in-game management is definitely there, and you can tell that there's thought going into the substitutions that he's making and things like that. But yeah, I think I'd like to just re-emphasise that the players are starting to do it now. They're showing that maturity, and that's all down to him as well. He's expecting them to problem solve. I think he said that before, and that's something that they're doing. But yeah, he'll happily change the shape. And it was weird. At times it looked like Danasian was playing right fullback. And I know it was the same. It's quite often the same when Burns is playing there. But then at times, and Jackson looked like he was playing in a three up front at times. And then you see him coming back. So I don't know whether he was instructing that or whether Jackson was just playing off the cuff. But yeah, it is really pleasing to see a good in-game manager making sensible substitutions at sensible times as well.
Do you think from his vantage point, Ian Westlake dropped him a note at half-time? Because he had it spot on, didn't he? You know, the wide players, Jackson and perhaps Lee, just get them further up the pitch, but don't make the pitch narrow, you know, don't make the pitch wider, which second half pretty much from the off is what they did. And it was so much better, wasn't it?
Yeah. Worth mentioning Edmondson, George here. Fridge did seem a little off a game. You'd have felt more confident with Key on the pitch for. Maybe there's an issue with injury still with Edmondson, maybe. Maybe we're being critical. Both him and Wolfenden will play and will maybe give the ball away in positions we don't want them to. But you know, that's part and parcel of a team that builds from the back. Hmm. Are you a little bit wary about Edmondson's form at the moment, Dave?
No, I don't think so. I mean, maybe we did have a big injury last season, didn't he? It's just a shame we're not still in the Carabao Cup, isn't it? You know, and that would have been a perfect game for Keogh to come into. But a big injury he had last season, so it's going to he's seemingly fairly up to speed. But yeah, if he is still feeling that a bit, then it is going to have an effect on his play, on his overall play.
Yeah. I mean, this to the point we were talking about before, Mikey, George Hutchings' point here, game management from 70 minutes onwards, very impressive. Same at Forest Green, a game of, you know, single goal margin.
Yeah.
You know, Burton had that one chance through Brayford after the kind of 70th minute mark, but comfortable, weren't we, to an extent? I know the balls were coming into the box and the throw-ins were there and the corners maybe.
But we were still getting corners as well, weren't we?
Yeah, we were.
We were taking the sting out of the game at times, and I know we conceded the throw and then the corner, but when they've got so many players up the pitch, that sort of thing is going to happen. I think
there was one small moment in about the 94th minute when Jackson Jackson was wide right and the ball was going out for a throw. All right, their throw, but literally right by their corner flag. And he tried to play it and kicked it in the touch for a goal kick. I must admit, I was bellowing at that stage. But
Walton played such a lovely pass out to him. Played it perfect because it didn't go out, did it? And Jackson just needed to kick it against him and get a corner.
Or just try and hold it up. But yeah, just small point. Yeah, it out.
We need to, again, temper everyone's little emotions. I did see some chats with numbers in them, 3-digit numbers. I'm not going to indulge that kind of stuff, guys. I love your optimism and happiness.
Also, well, you haven't touched on is the mysterious missile that was thrown at
Do you want to talk about that? I mean, it's not much we can say, really, apart from idiots of football, you know.
Seemingly.
Still find them.
Well, he was just getting in the way of everything tonight, wasn't he?
There you go, went on Mikey. Yep. FPL
surprised
transfer.
He didn't volley it back at him.
Chip it.
A lot of people were happy, which is good, and I don't want to be a party pooper, so I'm going to keep this question in there, but I just I'm harnessing my inner Ben Bloom. Who was the last town manager you had this much faith in, guys? George Burley, Joe Royal? It's a long old time, isn't it?
Do you know what? Maybe, it goes all the way back to probably, maybe Jim McChilton for the start of what season was that? 6-7, was it 7-8? Yeah. Which included the 4-1, the Sheffield Wednesday 4-1 win. We were sort of rolling, sort of playing, had a great start of the season and rolling things up. I mean, even that season, five seasons ago, when did we go 4 on the spin or something like that? First season of the pod when we won at Millwall, 4-3 and stuff. Yeah, you really didn't really.
Yesterday,
I think that was the year after, Dave. Because
was it?
Yeah, that was the.
That was 18.
That was another
18.
Year that we must have.
Oh, that might, no, I said you're right. That was 2 years after. That was 17-18, wasn't it?
Yeah,
right. That was 2 years after. So, first year of the pod, 15-16, was when we had Fraser, and we were on a good run and were top. Yeah,
And then 15-16, 17-18. And then, dare I say, 18, 19 and 19, 20. And now this season. So this is potentially 5 seasons of Blue Monday that we've been top of the league at this stage.
Let's not get too carried away.
Yeah.
I think we said this on the pod on Sunday, but this season, it just seems more, looking at the squad and the depth of the squad, more sustainable, perhaps.
Yeah.
It is. That is the word, isn't it? And we've got people joining us from overseas. Nathan from Melbourne. Got Rob from South Hungary. Need to help us with the pronunciation of Burley. Mikey, can you help me out? I don't know why I'm picking on you, but you've got Finnish roots, haven't you? You can help me out with
that's near Hungary. Come on, Mikey.
It's nearer than Ipswich.
Bolly gosh, I don't know.
Bolly.
Willie Bolly. Bolly.
There you go. A few more bits and pieces of plugs before we plough on with the remaining comments. Worth noting that the pre-match show will be back on Friday, talking about Shrewsbury. We'll also have a chat with Kieran Stanley from ITFC Women with their season due to start on Sunday. Make sure you get along to the AGL Arena in Felixstowe if you can. Tickets can be bought on the ITFC's ticket website, where you get your tickets for the men's games, or you can get True Blue membership from £5 a month, which is crazy. So do get involved in that. Well, the flagship show will be back live, as we're doing every week now, from 8 o'clock on Sunday. I think Seb and I will be there for Shrewsbury. I need to figure out who's on that, but probably Seb and I at least. So do get involved in that. Telegram group, who wants to big up the Telegram group? Very good and enjoyable to watch along the match with real-time chat, wasn't it, guys? So I'll just say that the Telegram group is really good. Get involved in that. Blue Monday, itfc.co.uk for all the details for stuff like that, including our merch store. Depending on when you're listening or watching this, from Wednesday, free shipping. So get yourself some Blue Monday merch and give a little bit back to the podcast channel. Again, if you're watching on YouTube, do give us a thumbs up. That really helps us, and a subscribe too. And if you want to support us through donations, again, Blue Monday, itfc.co.uk for all the details there. Let's talk about football, guys. I'm trying to find some comments that are a bit different from what I haven't talked about so far. A lot of people comparing Aluko and so on. There you go. Mikey, I don't know whether you nicked that from Chris or whether
I didn't. I'll plead innocence on that one, but great minds think alike.
Jack, yeah, good summary here. Away Tuesday night, opposition absolutely on it. Well, yeah, let's we pause and talk about Burton, because rightfully panned so far. And Dave, we discussed the 4-4 draw, which could have been, as I mentioned, a 5-4 defeat. But Burton, maybe they raised their game for us, perhaps. But
yeah, I think so. They're obviously a lot more tighter than certainly they had been in their first three or even four games. But yeah, they're looking at it, there wasn't really a lot there, was there? I mean, I'm not quite sure who they had out or who was playing, who normally would play. I don't think there was many. Yeah, you would think they are going to struggle again.
Yeah, I like the big number 9 though. I know he's already been mentioned, but he's mentioned in
this context, yep. Mikey. Not giving us
handful.
To ask too much.
Yeah, I'm just stealing all of my opinions from the comments.
That's my fault
for
being slow in the comments, guys.
But yeah, Edmund, he's right. And that is maybe a slight worry that, aside from this, there was a little bit of sloppiness in possession. I think we can probably put up with that with Wolford and Edmondson because of how much they give us on the ball. But they did struggle in the air as well, both of them. That maybe more so in the first half, but it makes a big difference when you're playing against teams that are lumping it into the box if you've got someone that can dominate. And Richard Keogh isn't that, by the way. Richard Keogh is another ball-playing centre-back. He's just a bit older.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that Burgess came on for Jackson, didn't he? He didn't really do much, but that was his job at Forest Green. So we do have Burgess who can do that role, and maybe he'll start a few games where that's the risk. Hello to Jim, another Telegram alumni. He's the car park champions, Nickett, he says, and Michael Cryer, he says, many match balls. There'll be some cars with windscreens smashed in from footballs landing on them, won't they? Or someone's got 100 quid's worth of Burton merch that they can stick on eBay. Michael also talks about Ladapo works hard, but we still have not got a number 9 who scored 10 goals, let alone 20. But do we need one? This debate continues, Dave.
It's continued most
the George
single,
Hurst saga
every single day, isn't it?
What do you think of Michael's point there?
Yeah, I mean, I think probably to any successful team that's looking to get promoted will have a number 9 that will chip in with, say, 10 goals, perhaps a minimum, perhaps 15 goals. So yeah, a necessity at this stage. You'd like it, but you know, when you see, you know, Harness, you know, everyone else is chipping in with goals, not such an issue. But yeah, you just want, I think there's certainly goals in the depot, takes up good positions. Like I said earlier, just needs to get off the mark. Then I think he could well be that 15, perhaps plus goal striker easily.
He just needs to get that first one, doesn't
he? Yeah, he does. Yeah,
Jack helpfully answering the question we pitched at the start.
Oh,
the last 3-game winning streak was Matt Gill. I mean, Paul Cook was, it's like, when it's like Boris Johnson is still the Prime Minister, but he's in Greece, isn't he, on holiday? Paul Cook, Matt Gill was basically, we thought Matt Gill was in charge for Hull and I forget the other two, but there you go. Thank you, Jack, for sorting us out. And apologies for going political there.
Shadow coach.
I shouldn't do that. And let's distract everyone by FPR tractors. Rich for new ITFC GK coach. I mean, I've criticised them enough, haven't I? So maybe it's time for me to put my money where my mouth is. A lot of people getting in on that point. So thank you, everyone. And for getting in on the chat there. What else have we got? A bit of chat about Ladapo. Someone's putting 3-digit numbers in the chat again. We've got someone, Simon from Sydney, looking very Hunter S. Thompson kind of.
Yeah, I like that Simon has danced into work and the first thing he's done is load up
joining
YouTube to watch this.
Yeah, working hard or hardly working. Thank you for joining us, Simon.
I love it.
Good to have you. What else have we got? Chris Rand on target for 80. Oh, come on, Chris. I should have read this before I put it up there. On target for 80 goals scored and fewer than 30 conceded. Well, obviously, silly.
We read out these statistics from Chris Rand when things aren't going well. So it's only right that for balance, we read them out when things are looking good.
The goals against under McKenna is a joke, isn't it? I mean, we barely concede.
Yep. And then Ben the Blue Walton is the key. Best in League One, I think I'd probably agree with that.
I think we would concur.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, Charlie, I won't read it out, Charlie, but you and me both, mate. Yeah. Sully mentions KVY. Did anyone want to talk about KVY, Mikey?
Showed a good burst of pace getting forward, didn't he? He took one really good touch to get the ball out of his feet, and just showing that pace, really flying, shows that he does have complete faith in his body. And I think that he could still be quite an important player. It must have been tough for him tonight not getting the call with Burns out, because right wing back, you think that that kind of is the perfect position for him really. And Jackson got the call up instead. It must have been a difficult one, but he came on, gave it his best. He didn't have too much to do, but yeah, that night, really nice burst of pace.
Yep. Last few messages, folks. If you want a shout out, if you want to give us a Shrewsbury prediction, if you want to talk about lineups and stuff like that, we'll do a burst of those before we go. What I do have to do, very obviously, is put up the league table. So I'm going to do that about now. Let's have a quick look at this. Got a loadout first.
I haven't seen it.
Hot off the press. There is the league table. Let me give you some results from tonight as well, to give some context. It's not working for me. Why does nothing work when I need it? Let's go through these. I don't know if these are in alphabetical order or what. Barnsley 3, Bristol Rovers 0, Bolton 1, Morecambe 0, Charlton 5, Plymouth Argyle 1. Plymouth, very much a home team, had James Wilson sent off for a handball in that one.
First half.
Exeter 3, Wickham 1. A lot of teams inconsistent start at the moment, haven't we? Fleetwood 0, Cheltenham 0. Probably a good result for Cheltenham there. MK bounced back from defeat to beat Port Vale 2-1. Oxford slow start continues, defeated 2-1 at home by Lincoln City. Mark Kennedy's Lincoln City. Peterborough Sheffield Wednesday, a big game early doors in the league between those two, and Peterborough came out on top after defeat against Plymouth last weekend.
Clark, I didn't see the scorers. Clark Harris or
Jack Taylor and Clark Harris. Yeah, had a sending off for Wednesday as well, and that Reece James, not that one, sent off for them. Portsmouth 4. They came from 1-0 down to win 4-1. Portsmouth there against Cambridge. Goals for Jacobs, Ogilvie, Bishop again, Ronan Curtis. So Portsmouth kind of maybe a bit of a dark horse. And then Shrewsbury Derby 0-0 there ahead of our game against Shrewsbury on the weekend. And there are Ipswich with a point advantage to second place Peterborough, 3-point advantage to Derby. Looking good, isn't it, chaps? Yes, it is.
We'd have taken it, wouldn't we?
Absolutely right. Talk to me about Shrewsbury. We'll be dealing with them on the pre-match show, but I mean, there's not much to say apart from keep going, isn't it, guys? Mikey, any rotational changes that you would
expect? It's going to be an interesting team sheet, this one, isn't it? Because so many people wanted to keep the same team from the Milton Keynes game. I wonder whether anyone's played themselves into genuine contention. I imagine Davis is going to come back in at left back, isn't he? Burns will come back in if he's fit, but potentially he's not. You'd think Chaplin's going to come back in. Yeah. Expect Ladapo to keep his place, although John Jules had a couple of nice touches when he came on. But I think because he needs that goal, doesn't he? And Nessie is just completely knackered because he did look it when he came off tonight, didn't he? But I imagine that it will probably be closer to the team that started the game against Milton Keynes rather than the one that started tonight against Burton. Feel pretty confident.
I think it will be perhaps a bit more of a football match, not quite so direct, I don't think, as Burton were this evening. So, yeah, like Mikey said, I'd expect the more injuries permitting a similar lineup to what started on Saturday.
Yeah, Shrewsbury, a win, two draws and a defeat so far, and a kind of a neutral goal difference, two goals against. So it could be another tight one, perhaps. But we'll drill more into Shrewsbury on Friday 7i for the pre-match show.
I think it's been pointed out in the comments that table wasn't completely accurate.
Oh, okay.
Some unupdated tables will be false.
But
the team at the top was definitely right.
Yeah. Who have I got wrong then?
That's what we're concerned about.
So have I been corrected with any specifics or not? It doesn't matter. We're top of the
league. I
don't
think it was fully updated yet, but I think, you get the gist of it, don't you?
Yeah, exactly right. World class. Thanks, Dave, for the spot. We're top of the league, guys. That's all we need to know. Adam Flatt, let's finish off. Let's plough through these. Buzzword is control, says Adam. Never had this under Lambert or Cook. That's the difference. Sebastian, one of our merch guys. Thank you, there, Sebastian, for getting involved with that. 2-1 with an Edmondson winner. There you go. Ladapo and Edmondson. Maybe that would be the nice a goal-scoring duo, wouldn't it? Michael's. I remember this from last season, Michael. Stay calm when we play out from the back. My wife says, I swear to you. I remember you talking about this, Michael. Yeah, poor cats. In McKenna, we trust, says FBL. Christopher's going confident. He's going for another 3-0. Yeah, table isn't in points order, everyone's saying. So thanks, guys. Apologies. I'm trying to, behind the curtain here, I'm running this live stream, auditing the chat, asking Mikey and Dave questions and trying to listen to them and screenshotting a web page, cropping the image, pasting it into the overlays and then loading it at the same time. So
not really multitasking.
Hopefully you can forgive me for that one. Apologies, but hopefully I got the results right at least. 3-1 on Saturday, headed goal from a corner, or am I just being silly? Says Michael. Pete, we had the best AMs, best winger, best CM in the league, and we don't need a goal machine up top. We need workhorses, which we have to give others space in McKenna. We believe that's what we want. Yeah, thanks everyone. I'm now seeing the league table comments. Lovely stuff. Stubbsy wants to go back to Burns and Davis. And he's going for a 2-0. And Mr. Ipswich Town, Paul Lambert is the profile photo. Shrews only had 27% possession against Derby. There you go. But got the point nevertheless. Thanks, Charlie, for getting involved. Got to keep up this confidence in the team. There you go. Thank you. Very finished problems, Mikey. That's not you multitasking now, is it?
No. That's, I think, yeah, he's a good follow. Even if you're not of Finnish heritage, really entertaining Twitter and Instagram feed. Very Finnish problems.
There you go. Very Finnish problems. Roberto 1000 and 1-0 to which comes Saturday. Very good. Thank you everyone for joining us. Thank you for your comments. Thank you for your thumbs up and your subscriptions and for joining us. Mikey, Dave, thank you for that. On the evening, Ipswich Town beat Burton 1-0. Mikey, final word from you before we say goodbye.
Thanks for not bullying me tonight, Dave. You just let me get on with it, play my podcasting. But no, these are enjoyable times. Yeah, we're not perfect just yet, but let's enjoy the journey.
Dave?
Just a quick plug, really. I'll be guesting on the excellent Naked Football Show tomorrow evening with the great GB. So looking forward to that. And yeah, just to echo what Mikey said, his hopefully 3 more points, welcome points on Saturday.
Very good. Well, there you go. Naked Footy with GB and David Diamond. We'll be back on Friday for the pre-match and we'll be live 8 p.m. on Sunday to talk about Shrewsbury. Hopefully you can join us then and hopefully we'll still be top of the league.